Tant or Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mosby's Rangers, a record of the operations of the 43rd Battalion, Virginia Cavalry, from its organization to the surrender, by James Joseph Williamson, narrated by Tom Perkins. Preface to Revised Edition. It is my purpose in this revised edition to correct errors, supply omissions, and add such new material as I have collected since its first publication. In doing this, I sought the cooperation of my old comrades, asking them to call my attention to any statements which they found at variance with their knowledge of affairs, or where they may have had better opportunities of learning the facts. After the close of the war and the disbanding of our command, the survivors scattered over the country, some even seeking refuge beyond the border, so that it was difficult to ascertain the whereabouts of parties to obtain information regarding affairs of which I had but few details. Even when these were found, it was sometimes hard to reconcile contrary statements. Two persons, perfectly honest, equally reliable, and either with or without prejudice, will give different versions of the same occurrence, each viewing it from his own standpoint. This is particularly noticeable in recounting the details of a fight, where each one usually has sufficient to demand attention in his own immediate vicinity, and things may take place at a little distance from him, or without his range of vision unnoticed by him, though plainly seen by others. Aware of this, I have sought to get the statements of others, not only to verify my own, but to add to my account what may have escaped my observation or may be brought to my recollection in this way. The reunions of these later years have brought together the survivors and given an opportunity of picking up many missing links. There are, no doubt, many things yet which are not mentioned in this work. I have had comrades say, "You do not speak of a little affair which took place at," naming time or place. In the good book, St. John tells us, there are also many other things which, if they were written every one, the world itself would not be able to contain the books that should be written. While the bulk of the command was on an excursion in the Shenandoah Valley or in Fairfax, small squads would be out in various directions. Consequently, many occurrences are not noted, and the affair omitted may in some instances strike the participant as being more important than others here given. In keeping a diary, which was the foundation of this work, I simply followed a habit which had become an amusement, and at the time I had no thought of publishing. Had I entertained a suspicion of this, I would have been more industrious in collecting data of important facts and interesting incidents. I now see, with regret, where I could have obtained a fund of entertaining matter, which I did not even take pains to inquire into or make note of at the time. So it is with us all, to a greater or less extent. As we grow older, we all look back with regret at our lost opportunities. Preface to First Edition. The object of this work is to put in durable form a record of the exciting scenes and events in the career of Mosby's Rangers, in most of which I was an humble actor, and to preserve the memory of the gallant deeds of Colonel Mosby and of his brave companions who shed their blood, and of our heroic dead who gave up their lives in the cause for which we fought. It is unnecessary at this late day to vindicate the military career of Mosby, or to justify his taking up arms in obedience to the call of his state. The falsehoods so industriously circulated concerning Mosby's men during the excitement of the war by partisan newsmongers, who are often too ready to pander to popular sentiment without regard to truth, have been forever set at rest by the many complimentary letters and notices regarding Mosby from Generals Lee, Stuart, Grant, and others, Federal and Confederate. The main events of the war have long since passed into history and will now be judged by unprejudiced minds that will award to all their just measure of commendation or censure. I have worked with an honest purpose. While I have presented the facts and have given the best versions I could of matters from my standpoint, I have also deemed it only fair to give the other side of the story, when obtainable, as it is my desire to do justice to all, whether friend or foe. This book is really the result of the habit of keeping a diary. During my imprisonment in the spring of 1863, in the old Capitol prison in Washington, I kept a diary as a means of whiling away the tedious hours of prison life. After being exchanged, I joined Mosby in April 1863, 2 months before the organization of Company A, his first company, and was with him until the surrender. The habit I acquired while in prison still clung to me when I entered upon the active life of a ranger. It then became a pleasure to jot down the events that came under my observation or that I heard related by my comrades or others. I soon began to feel that my work was not completed until I had noted down briefly what had happened during the day. In this way, my diary was kept, sometimes written by the wayside, sometimes by the campfire, sometimes in the quiet of the fireside. As time went on, my interest in the record increased, though it was kept simply as a matter of habit and amusement, not with any idea of publication. In after years, realizing that I was growing old and that my old comrades were dropping off one after another, it occurred to me that the surviving members of the command might be interested in this little diary if written up and put in suitable form. My first idea, when preparing the manuscript, was to publish it as a magazine article under the title of Leaves from the Diary of One of Mosby's Men. Then I set about collecting portraits of officers and members of the command, in which I succeeded far beyond my expectations. I also procured from the records of the War Department official federal reports relating to many matters in order to give the federal version. The work grew on my hands. Meeting my old friend, Ralph B. Kenyon, the publisher, about this time, and telling him what I contemplated, he said that my record supplied too important a chapter of war history to be hidden under such a title and published in such a way, and an arrangement was soon made to print it as a history of Mosby's Rangers. Once in hand, no pains or expense have been spared to make the work as complete as possible in all its details, so that it might be not only an accurate and authentic record of the doings of Mosby's men, but that for the surviving members it might be a souvenir of the old days. Whether this has been accomplished or not, the book must speak for itself. I am glad of this opportunity to make grateful acknowledgement to many friends and comrades whose names and portraits appear in these pages, who have assisted me, both in collecting pictures and in furnishing details where my record was imperfect or fragmentary. Among these, I am particularly under obligations to Mr. George S. Ayer, Lieutenant W. Ben Palmer, Charles H. Deere, Captain Walter E. Frankland, John H. Foster, Joseph W. Owen, Lieutenant Channing Smith, John N. Ballard, Lieutenant Joseph H. Nelson, and Zachary F. Jones. I have also drawn heavily on the pictorial collections of James E. Taylor and Charles Hall, who were both in the ranks of the Federal Army, but who have since proved my warm friends and earnest helpers. Enemies in war, in peace, friends. Ties of friendship were formed with companions in arms which death alone can sever. It is with mingled emotions of sadness and pleasure that we cast a fond, lingering look back through the misty past and re-enjoy, in some measure, many happy hours, which amid all the hardships and disappointments of those exciting times appear in the retrospect like green spots in the journey of life. If this work will refresh the memory of my comrades and thus enable them to live over again some of the old scenes and at the same time be the means of convincing our northern brothers that Mosby's men were not quite so bad as they have been represented to be, the hope of the author will be realized. J.J.W., Jersey City, New Jersey, February 1896. Mosby's Rangers. Chapter 1. Early in the spring of 1863, after an imprisonment of some months in the old capital at Washington, which had been converted into a political prison, the writer was sent, together with a number of others, via Fortress Monroe and City Point, to the parole camp at Model Farm Barracks near Petersburg, where we were detained about 2 weeks until exchanged. Among the acquaintances I had made in prison were six young men who, like myself, being denied the privilege of returning to their homes, had determined to unite their fortunes with Captain Mosby, who was then making a reputation by his dashing and successful exploits. The injustice of my imprisonment and the arbitrary and partisan oath offered me as a condition of release alienated, or rather hardened, my feelings, so that I readily joined this party, and together we started in search of the daring ranger. Journeying from Petersburg to Gordonsville by railroad, we proceeded thence on foot through the country to that portion of Virginia occupied by Mosby. When we reached the little town of Upperville, in Fauquier County, we learned that there was to be a meeting of Mosby's men at that place on the following day. So, after a night's rest and breakfast in the morning, we walked out through the town and saw them coming in from various directions. Soon, I beheld Mosby himself. From the accounts which I had heard and read of him, I expected to see a man such as novelists picture when describing some terrible brigand chief. I was therefore somewhat surprised when one of my companions pointed to a rather slender but wiry-looking young man of medium height, with light hair, keen eyes, and pleasant expression, who was restlessly walking up and down the street, and said, "There is Mosby." I could scarcely believe that the slight frame before me could be that of the man who had won such military fame by his daring. John Singleton Mosby was born at Edgemont, Powhatan County, Virginia, December 6, 1833. His father was Alfred D. Mosby of Amherst County, and his mother, Virginia I., daughter of Reverend Mr. McLaurin, an Episcopal minister. He graduated at the University of Virginia and began the study of law. After completing his studies, he settled in Bristol, a small town on the boundary line of Virginia and Tennessee, where he successfully practiced his profession. He married Miss Pauline Clark, daughter of Honorable Beverly J. Clark of Kentucky, formerly United States Minister to Central America and at one time a member of Congress. At the commencement of the war, Mosby was engaged in the practice of law. He entered the Army as a private in a cavalry company, the Washington Mounted Rifles, commanded by Captain William E. Jones, afterward General Jones. This company was incorporated in the 1st Regiment, Virginia Cavalry, Captain Jones being promoted to the command, and Mosby was appointed adjutant of the regiment. By the reorganization of the regiment, Colonel Jones was thrown out, and consequently his adjutant relieved of duty. Mosby was then chosen by General J.E.B. Stuart as an independent scout. He was the first to make the circuit of the Federal Army while in front of Richmond, thereby enabling General Stuart to make his celebrated raid around the entire army of General McClellan, on which occasion Mosby went as guide. Feeling that there was a wide field for the successful career as a partisan which he had mapped out for himself, Mosby urged General Stuart to give him a small detail of men with which to operate until he could enlist a command. While he met with a refusal of this request, he was given a letter recommending him to General Jackson, then in the vicinity of Gordonsville. It happened that General Rufus King, who was in command of the Federal forces at Fredericksburg at this time, was ordered by General Pope to send out a raiding party for the purpose of destroying as much as possible the Virginia Central Railroad and so interrupt communication between Richmond and the Valley. Mosby encountered this party near Beaver Dam, was captured by the 2nd New York Cavalry, Harris Light, Colonel J. Mansfield Davies, and sent as a prisoner to Washington. After his release from the old capital, and while on the prison transport awaiting exchange, Mosby saw the transports bringing Burnside's forces from the south, and learned from conversations on board the prison boat that the troops were destined for Fredericksburg to unite with Pope, then on the Rapidan, and not to reinforce McClellan. As soon as the exchange was effected, Mosby hastened to Richmond and imparted this information to General Lee, who immediately dispatched a courier to General Jackson. The result was the Battle of Cedar Mountain. How well Mosby performed his duty as a scout is shown by the following. Special Order Number 82. His Excellency the President has pleased to show his appreciation of the good services and many daring exploits of the gallant John S. Mosby by promoting the latter to a captaincy in the Provisional Army of the Confederate States. The General Commanding is confident that this manifestation of the approbation of his superiors will but serve to incite Captain Mosby to still greater efforts to advance the good of the cause in which we are engaged. He will at once proceed to organize his command, as indicated in the letter of instructions this day furnished to him from this headquarters. By command of General R. E. Lee, W. W. Taylor, AAG. The winter of 1863, about the time Mosby was budding into notoriety, was a season of remarkable activity for the Confederate cavalry. Their bold and successful raids and daring attacks and surprises had filled the breasts of the young cavaliers with most romantic visions and ardent desires to enter upon this life of wild adventure. Stuart's brilliant achievements, General Imboden's forays in the Shenandoah Valley, Fitzhugh Lee on the Rappahannock, General William E. Jones's attack and rout of Milroy's cavalry in the valley, the daring raids of Major E. V. White and his Loudoun Rangers along the Potomac, and the dashes of Captain Randolph, with his famous Black Horse Cavalry, furnished material for stories which read like the deeds of heroes of romance, and charmed the little groups around the firesides of cabin and hall. At first, a few men from the 1st Regiment Virginia Cavalry were detailed to act with Mosby, but he soon succeeded in obtaining a sufficient number of volunteers, and the detailed men were then, with a few exceptions, sent back to their commands. Mosby's men, when not on duty, were mostly scattered through the counties of Loudoun and Fauquier. There were few indeed, even among the poorest mountaineers, who would refuse shelter and food to Mosby's rangers. Having no camps, they made their homes at the farmhouses, especially those along the Blue Ridge and Bull Run Mountains. Certain places would be designated at which to meet, but if no time or place had been named at a former meeting, or if necessary to have the command together before a time appointed, couriers were dispatched through the country, and men thus notified. Scouts were out at all times in Fairfax or along the Potomac or in the Shenandoah Valley. Whenever an opening was seen for successful operations, couriers were sent from headquarters, and in a few hours a number of well-mounted and equipped men were at a prescribed rendezvous ready to surprise a picket, capture a train, or attack a camp or body of cavalry. After a raid, the men scattered, and to the Federal cavalry in pursuit it was like chasing a will-o'-the-wisp. The command was composed chiefly of young men from Fairfax and the adjoining counties, with some Marylanders, many of whom had been arrested and imprisoned or had suffered injuries and injustice at the hands of the Federal government or the invading army. It was the custom of many Federal officers to retaliate upon defenseless citizens for injuries inflicted upon them by Confederate soldiers, and can anyone feel surprised at Mosby's men taking up arms to protect themselves or to avenge their wrongs? A large number lived in that portion of Virginia and Maryland where Mosby was operating, and naturally preferred serving with him, as they were kept nearer home and could enjoy the privilege of seeing their families. There was always a little jealousy existing between the cavalry and infantry, many of whom lost no opportunity of having a thrust at their rivals. Illustrative of this ran the old joke of the day, which will be remembered by the survivors of the war. An old straggling infantryman, trudging wearily on the road, was overtaken by a cavalryman riding briskly along, who called out, "Hurry up there, old Webfoot! The Yankees are coming!" "Did you see 'em, mister?" queried the infantryman. "Yes, they are coming on right behind us," replied the trooper. "Say, mister, was your horse lame or was your spurs broke?" retorted the Webfoot. So also the regular cavalry, viewing the comparative freedom of the life of the partisan ranger in contrast with the dull routine and more rigid discipline of camp life, sometimes gave vent to their feelings, and half in jest and half in earnest would banter the rangers, calling them carpet knights or featherbed soldiers. But when a sacrifice was required, the carpet knights shed their blood and gave up their lives as freely as did the knights of old in the palmiest days of chivalry. The saber was no favorite with Mosby's men. They looked upon it as an obsolete weapon, and very few carried carbines. In the stillness of the night, the clanking of the sabers and the rattle of the carbines striking against the saddles could be heard for a great distance, and would often betray us when moving cautiously in the vicinity of the Federal camps. We sometimes passed between camps but a few hundred yards apart. We would then leave the hard roads where the noise of the horses' hoofs would attract attention, and, marching through the grassy fields, take down bars or fences and pass quietly through. The carbine was for long-range shooting. With us the fighting was mostly at close quarters, and the revolver was then used with deadly effect. I well remember on one occasion when, falling back before the Federal advance on the Little River Turnpike, alternately halting and retreating, the monotony varied only by an occasional long-range shot, brave, bluff Lieutenant Harry Hatcher impatiently exclaimed to a superior officer, "If you are going to fight, fight. And if you are going to run, run. But quit this damn nonsense." Regarding the custom of our northern brethren, when speaking of Mosby's men, to use the terms guerrillas, bushwhackers, freebooters, and the like, I will only say that Mosby's command was regularly organized and mustered into the Confederate service on the same footing with other troops, except that being organized under the Partisan Ranger Law, an act passed by the Confederate Congress, they were allowed the benefit of the law applying to maritime prizes. All cattle and mules were turned over to the Confederate government, but horses captured were distributed among the men making the capture. When it is borne in mind that the men had to arm, equip, and support themselves, this did not leave a very heavy surplus, as we received but little aid from the government. The Greenback raid was the only one that brought in any great return, and there were only about 80 men who reaped the benefit of it, as the proceeds of a capture went directly to the men making it. The acquisition of arms and accoutrements, or even horses, did not make the men wealthy. Wagons and supplies were destroyed, though, of course, the men were allowed to appropriate anything they chose before destroying the captured stores. Mosby was acting under direct orders of General Stuart up to the time of his death, and then under General Lee, and was independent only in the sense that both Lee and Stuart had such confidence in him that they permitted him to act on his own discretion. In fact, it would have been folly to hamper him with orders or place him under restrictions when he was so far separated from the main army, and at times so situated that he could with difficulty communicate with his superiors. It has been charged that Mosby's men went in the disguise of Federal soldiers. Such was not the case. They never masqueraded in the uniforms of Federals, except that through force of circumstances, men at times wore blue overcoats captured by them from Federal cavalry. This was done because they could get no others. The Confederate government did not, or could not, at all times provide proper clothing, and our soldiers were compelled to wear these to protect themselves from the cold. Rubber blankets were common to both armies, and when one was worn, it completely hid the uniform. The Jesse Scouts of the Federal Army, however, will be well remembered by the soldiers of both armies. They dressed in the regular Confederate uniform, which they wore for the purpose of deceiving our men. Dr. Montero, in his very entertaining volume of reminiscences of Mosby's command, says, "Every man knew that the slightest suspicion of dishonesty or cowardice would consign him at once to the disgrace of expulsion, and although there must have been the usual modicum of human meanness always found in a given number of human beings, I am enabled to say, after 3 years of active field service in the regular army, that I have never witnessed amongst 800 men and officers more true courage and chivalry, or a higher sense of honor blended with less vice, selfishness, and meanness than I found during my official intercourse with the Partisan Battalion." To this, I will add a tribute, which will certainly be regarded as unprejudiced. In the life of General Sheridan, on page 314, in speaking of old rosters, the author says, "But one of the most remarkable of Confederate cavalrymen is never named in these rosters. Yet he held, having won it fairly, the commission of colonel. John S. Mosby, the partisan leader of Northern Virginia, deserves a place in any reference to the doings and deeds of the Confederate troopers. He deserves it because he is a man of character enough to win the respect of his foe, and since the war closed, to have induced General Grant to write of him as follows, after having appointed him consul to Hong Kong: 'Since the close of the war, I have come to know Mosby, personally and somewhat intimately. He is a different man entirely from what I supposed. He is slender, not tall, wiry, and looks as if he could endure any amount of physical exercise. He is able and thoroughly honest and truthful. There were probably but few men in the South who could have commanded successfully a separate detachment in the rear of an opposing army, and so near the borders of hostilities as long as he did without losing his entire command.'" Grant's Memoirs, Volume 2, page 142. Perhaps nothing will illustrate Mosby's intelligence as a soldier and the amount he accomplished better than his own statement of the theory upon which he acted as a partisan leader, and the recognition of his services in that capacity which he received from his superiors. Of the first, Colonel Mosby says that he was never a spy, and that his warfare was always such as the laws of war allow. He epitomizes his theory of action as follows: "As a line is only as strong as its weakest point, it was necessary for it to be stronger than I was at every point in order to resist my attacks. To destroy supply trains, to break up the means of conveying intelligence and thus isolating an army from its base, as well as its different corps from each other, to confuse plans by capturing dispatches, are the objects of partisan warfare. The military value of a partisan's work is not measured by the amount of property destroyed or the number of men killed or captured, but by the number he keeps watching. Every soldier withdrawn from the front to guard the rear of an army is so much taken from its fighting strength." After Mosby had attracted attention by his daring achievements, men came from all parts of the country to join him. Officers resigned positions in the regular army and came to Mosby to serve as privates. Even the famed armies of the Old World were not without representatives in his ranks. Although a dangerous service, there was a fascination in the life of a ranger. The changing scenes, the wild adventure, and even the dangers themselves exerted a seductive influence which attracted many to the side of the dashing partisan chief. An Austrian general, speaking of Napoleon I, said indignantly, "This beardless youth ought to have been beaten over and over again, for who ever saw such tactics? The blockhead knows nothing of the rules of war. Today he is in our rear, tomorrow in our flank, and the next day in our front. Such gross violations of the established principles of war are insufferable." but Napoleon was generally successful. Mosby, disregarding established rules, fought upon a principle which his enemies could neither discover nor guard against. He was in their front, in their rear, on their flank, at one place today and tomorrow in their camps at a point far distant. By his enemies he was thought to be almost ubiquitous. What he lacked in numbers he compensated for by the celerity of his movements and the boldness of his attacks. He generally fought against odds, often great odds, seldom waited to receive a charge, but nearly always sought to make the attack. A federal officer whom we captured when Meade's army followed Lee into Virginia after the Battle of Gettysburg said, "Yesterday I heard our cavalry were chasing you in our front, and who would expect to find you this morning in the very midst of our army?" Chapter 2. Mosby's growing fame was greatly increased by the capture of Brigadier General Stoughton at Fairfax Courthouse on the night of March 8, 1863. This bold enterprise was effected by Mosby, who penetrated the Federal lines with 29 men and succeeded in bringing off his captures without loss or injury. The raid on Fairfax Courthouse and capture of General Stoughton was accomplished a short time previous to my joining Mosby, but being one of the most important events in the history of our command, I make it a prominent feature. Captain Walter E. Franklin has given me the following very interesting narrative, embracing reminiscences of his first days with Mosby, the desertion of Sergeant Ames, Big Yankee, and the particulars of his visit to the camp of the 5th New York Cavalry in company with Ames, which occurred just 1 week prior to and suggested the capture of General Stoughton. Captain Walter E. Franklin's Narrative. Having served as private in the Warrenton Rifles, Company K, 17th Virginia Infantry, from Sunday, April 21, 1861, until late in 1862, when I was honorably discharged at Richmond, where I had been on detached duty in the Provost Marshal's office several months, I started with a friend, George Whitescarver, to join Colonel E.V. White's cavalry, then in Loudoun. After spending several weeks among his relatives in Upper Fauquier, Whitescarver and I, about February 10, 1863, were joined at Salem, now Marshall, by Joseph H. Nelson, and at sundown that evening we three drew up at the hospitable home of James H. Hathaway. A little later in the evening, a lone horseman, Frank Williams, rode up and was also welcomed to its cordial entertainment. I little dreamed that the life ties born at that supper table, where most of us first met, were destined to bind us through scenes of blood and years of strife and peace. We four, Nelson and Williams mounted, Whitescarver and myself afoot, resolved to go together to Loudoun and fulfill my original purpose, when for the first time we were told by Mr. Hathaway of a private scout named Mosby, who had made several successful attacks on the Federal pickets with a detail of 15 men of Stuart's cavalry, and they were to meet the next day at Rector's Crossroads to make another raid. At Mr. Hathaway's earnest suggestion, we concluded to see Mosby the next day before joining White's command. We set out after an early breakfast and reached the rendezvous in time to see Mosby, who was then but a private in rank with a dozen men, part of his detail having been captured, but who was destined to prove the most remarkable, indomitable, and successful warrior in that line developed by the Great Civil War, or known in American history. I was made spokesman, and soon we arranged to join him as his own men, being his first four. Frank Williams and Joseph Nelson, having horses of their own, accompanied Mosby on that raid, and as Mosby was to mount Whitescarver and myself from his captures, we secured quarters at the very retired little cottage of a poor widow named Rutter. There we awaited Mosby's return, but to be disappointed by his failure to bring us horses, so Whitescarver borrowed one and went on the next, the Ox Road, raid, leaving me on February 25th. Just before they rode off, a Yankee deserter, Sergeant James F. Ames of the 5th New York Cavalry, afterwards known as Big Yankee, came walking up and wanted to join Mosby. No one gave any credence to his story, but I took him with me to the old widow's house, where we slept and ate together several days and nights. He impressed me as a true man, assuring me he had deserted on account of the Emancipation Proclamation, which, he said, showed that the war had become a war for the Negro instead of a war for the Union. Mosby's raid proved futile as to mounting me, for the captures were divided among the participants. Ames had so far gained my confidence that I had arranged with him, and we had prepared our arms to make a trip to his late camp at Germantown to supply ourselves with horses. The day after Mosby's return, we two started from the old widow's house near Rector's Crossroads, February 28, 1863, for a 30 miles walk to the camp of the 5th New York Cavalry at Germantown, about 2 miles from Fairfax Courthouse. Before we reached Middleburg, a heavy rain was falling, and when we turned into the old Braddock Road below Aldi, which we took for privacy, the mud was deep and slippery, like putty. We pushed on, making slow progress, our boots heavy with mud and clothing saturated. And when Saturday night came, only half our journey was accomplished, the darkness intense and the rain pouring down. We begged quarters for the night on the roadside several miles from Cub Run, and from there resumed our trip after an early hot breakfast before day on Sunday morning, March 1st. Leaving the old Braddock Road, we crossed the field and entered the woods, in which we soon came to Cub Run on a boom. Every crossing log was gone, so we improvised a raft of fence rails, which the whirling torrent drove to pieces just as it struck the other bank. But it had served our purpose, and we were safe and at liberty to pursue our mission. We then took our way leisurely, as we had all day in which to make 12 or 15 miles, as we wanted twilight to cover our near approach to the camp, and caution was necessary lest the Federal scouts or trespassing parties might detect us and defeat our purpose. We learned from citizens that a raid to capture Mosby was about to be made, and by 7 p.m., when we reached the little pine cliff at the rear of the 5th New York camp at Germantown, we found the regiment all astir with preparation. It was Sunday night, March 1st, and we watched their movements from our admirable position. When taps sounded, all quieted down. The clouds were gone. The moon shone brightly, and we could see the sentinel pacing to and fro, guarding the officers' horses, our object. But the camp was restless, and every now and then others, besides the guard, could be seen moving about. So we waited for the dead hour to come. At midnight, the bugle sounded, and the horses were saddled up, including the two we had come after. About 200 men from the 5th New York and 18th Pennsylvania Cavalry formed on the Little River Turnpike and marched off, commanded by Major Joseph Gilmer of the latter regiment. We waited until the sounds of the cavalry horses died away, and then deliberately walked to the middle of the camp and talked freely to the guard, who never suspected us. Even when we walked into two of the stalls he was guarding, bridled two of the horses, mounted them in his presence, and rode away in a walk. We hoped to reach Mosby before the raiding party, but stiff mud roads were too much for us, and before we succeeded in rejoining him, Mosby, with a few men, had surprised the 1st Vermont and Aldi. After they, the Vermonters, had scared Major Gilmer and his 200 men into a most disgraceful retreat of 10 miles, capturing Captain Huntoon, 19 men, and 23 horses. Thus, after vainly waiting about 2 weeks for Mosby to mount me, the captured horses each time being only sufficient for the men who were on the raids, I had, accompanied and guided by Ames, penetrated the Federal lines to the camp of the 5th New York Cavalry at Germantown, within 2 miles of Fairfax Courthouse, walking 30 miles to accomplish it in order to mount myself. The success of this enterprise demonstrated the feasibility of passing in between their camps, evading their pickets and far within their lines, quietly executing a purpose without causing an alarm. Mosby's quick perception turned this to good account by arranging at once to strike deep for some great achievement, and just 1 week after my success of Sunday, March 1st, Mosby, with 29 of us on Sunday, March 8th, undertook and successfully executed an enterprise which made him and his command renowned, and brought to his standard hundreds of brave spirits who possessed the very mettle he needed to build with, and who were, in every way, worthy of their illustrious leader. It was the capture of General Stoughton. The best account of the raid and capture of General Stoughton obtainable is the following article from the able pen of Mosby himself, as published in the Belford Magazine in 1892. One of My War Adventures. About February 1st, 1863, I began operating on the outposts of the troops belonging to the defense of Washington that were stationed in Fairfax and Loudoun counties, Virginia. I had with me a detachment of 15 men from the 1st Virginia Cavalry, which Stuart had allowed to go with me while his cavalry corps was in winter quarters. As I had camped several months in Fairfax the year before, and on picket duty along the Potomac, I had acquired considerable local knowledge of the country. By questioning the prisoners I took, separately and apart from each other, I had learned the location of the camps and the headquarters of the principal officers. I had been meditating a raid on Fairfax Courthouse, where I knew there were many rich prizes, when fortunately Ames, a deserter from the 5th New York Cavalry, came to my command and supplied all the missing links in the chain of evidence. Whenever we made any captures, the prisoners were sent under guard to Culpeper Courthouse, where Fitz Lee was stationed with a brigade of cavalry. Stuart was then in the vicinity of Fredericksburg. I have heretofore related the affair with Major Gilmer and the 1st Vermont Cavalry, which occurred on March 2nd. As it was necessary to make a detail from the men serving with me to guard the prisoners that were sent to Culpeper, I had to wait several days for them to return before undertaking another enterprise. Gilmer's expedition into our territory had been so disastrous that the Union cavalry seemed to be content to stay in camp and let us alone. On the afternoon of March 8th, the anniversary of the day that my regiment, 1st Virginia Cavalry, had, the year before, crossed Bull Run as the rear guard covering the retirement of Johnson's army to Richmond, 29 men met me at Aldie in Loudoun County, the appointed rendezvous. My recollection of events is refreshed by my report to Stuart, written 3 days afterwards, which is printed in the official records by the government. I did not communicate my purpose of making a raid on the headquarters of the commanding general at Fairfax Courthouse to any of the men except Ames, and not to him until we started. The men thought we were simply going down to make an attack on a picket post. It was late in the afternoon when we left Aldie. There was a melting snow on the ground, with a drizzling rain. All this favored my plan. The darkness concealed us, and the horses treading on the soft snow made very little noise. We started down the Little River Turnpike, which runs by Fairfax Courthouse, to Alexandria. From Fairfax Courthouse, another turnpike runs easterly by Centerville, 7 miles distant, to Warrenton. At Centerville, there was a brigade of infantry with artillery and cavalry. This was the extreme outpost. From Centerville, there was a chain of outposts extending in one direction, by Frying Pan, to the Potomac, and to Union Mills and Fairfax Station in the other. Near the junction of the two turnpikes, a mile east of Fairfax Courthouse, there was a brigade of cavalry in camp. The railroad from Union Mills to Alexandria was strongly guarded. At Chantilly, on the Little River Pike, there was also a strong cavalry outpost. The two turnpikes that connected near Fairfax Courthouse and the picket line from Centerville to Frying Pan thus formed a triangle. I found out where there was a gap in the picket line between the two turnpikes and determined to penetrate it. I knew that if we succeeded in passing the outer line without alarming the pickets, we might reach the general's headquarters at the courthouse in comparative safety, as we would be mistaken for their own troops, even if the enemy discovered us. The headquarters were so thoroughly girdled with troops that no one dreamed of the possibility of an enemy approaching them. In justice to Stoughton, the commanding general, I must say that he had called the attention of the outpost commander to the weak point in his picket line, but no attention was paid to it. He did not conceive that anyone had the audacity to pass his pickets and ride into his camps. The commander of the Union cavalry at that time was Colonel Percy Wyndham, an English adventurer, who, it was said, had served with Garibaldi. He had been greatly exasperated by my midnight forays on his outposts and mortified at his own unsuccessful attempts at reprisal. In consequence, he had sent me many insulting messages. I thought I would put a stop to his talk by gobbling him up in bed and sending him off to Richmond. Ashby had captured him in the Shenandoah Valley the year before. When we got to within 3 miles of Chantilly, we turned off to the right from the turnpike and passed unobserved through the picket line about midway between that place and Centerville, and reached the Warrenton Turnpike about halfway between Centerville and the courthouse. I was riding by the side of one of my men named Hunter, and at this point I told him where we were going. He realized, as I did, the difficulties and dangers that surrounded us. I told him our safety was in the audacity of the enterprise. We were then 4 miles inside the enemy's line and within a mile or two of the cavalry companies. We could, no doubt, have marched straight into them or challenged and brought off a lot of men and horses. But I was hunting that night for bigger game and knew that Wyndham did not sleep in the cavalry camp but at the courthouse a mile beyond. I also knew that General Stoughton's headquarters were there. To a man uninitiated into the mysteries of war, our situation, environed on all sides by hostile troops, would have appeared desperate. To me it did not seem at all so, as my experience enabled me to measure the danger. Proceeding a short distance on the pike towards the courthouse, we turned off to the right, flanked the corps directly in front of us, and came into the town unmolested at 2 o'clock in the morning. It had been my intention to get there about midnight, but our column got broken in two at one time in the darkness. The rear portion remained standing still for some time, thinking the whole column had halted. We had gone a considerable distance before it was discovered, so I had to turn back in search of the missing. The rear, after standing still some time, moved on but could not find our trail. They were on the point of going back when by accident we came upon them wandering in the dark like Iris in search of the lost Osiris. This involved considerable delay. With the exception of a few drowsy sentinels, all the troops in the town were asleep. Nothing of the kind had ever been attempted before during the war, and no preparations had been made to guard against it. It is only practicable to guard against what is probable, and in war, as everything else, a great deal must be left to chance. Once inside the enemy's lines, everything we discovered as easy as falling off a log. There was not the slightest show of resistance. As the night was pitch dark, it was impossible to tell from our appearance to which side we belonged, although all of us were dressed in Confederate gray. The names of all the cavalry regiments stationed there were familiar to us, so whenever a sentinel halted us, the answer was, 5th New York Cavalry, and it was all right. Of course, we took the sentinel with us. All of my men, except Hunter and Ames, were as much surprised as the enemies were when they found themselves in a town filled with Union troops and stores. As I had never led them into a place from which I was not able to take them out, there was not a faint heart among them. All seemed to have a blind confidence in my destiny. Hunter was, at the time, a sergeant in the company to which he belonged. I explained the situation to him as we were riding along, as I looked to him more than to any of the men to aid me in accomplishing my design. He showed great coolness and courage and fully merited the promotion he soon afterwards received. He is now a citizen of California. I had only 29 men. We were surrounded by hostile thousands. Ames, who also knew to what point he was piloting us, rode by my side. Without being able to give any satisfactory reason for it, I felt an instinctive trust in his fidelity, which he never betrayed. When we reached the courthouse square, which was appointed as a rendezvous, the men were detailed in squads. Some were sent to the stables to collect the fine horses that I knew were there, others to the different headquarters where the officers were quartered. We were more anxious to capture Wyndham than any other. There was a hospital on the main street in a building which had been a hotel. In front of it, a sentry was walking. The first thing I did was to send Ames and Franklin to relieve him from duty and to prevent any of the occupants from giving the alarm. Ames whispered gently into his ear to keep quiet, that he was a prisoner. A six-shooter has great persuasive powers. I went directly with the larger portion of the command to the house of a citizen named Murray, which I had been told was Wyndham's headquarters. This was not so. He told us that they were at Judge Thomas's house, which we had passed in the other end of the town. So we quickly returned to the courthouse square. Ames was sent with a party to Wyndham's headquarters. Two of his staff were found there asleep, but the bird we were trying to catch had flown. Wyndham had gone down to Washington that evening by the railroad. My men indemnified themselves to some extent for the loss by appropriating his fine wardrobe and several splendid horses that they found in the stables. The irony of fortune made Ames the captor of his own captain. He was Captain Barker, 5th New York Cavalry, detailed as Assistant Adjutant General. Ames treated his former commander with the greatest civility, and seemed to feel his great pride in introducing him to me. Joe Nelson saw a tent in the courtyard. He went in and took the telegraph operator, who was sleeping there. We had already cut the wires before we came into the town to prevent communication with Centerville. Joe had also caught a soldier who told him that he was one of the guard at General Stoughton's headquarters. This was the reason I did not go with Ames after Wyndham. I took 5 or 6 men with me to go after Stoughton. I remember the names of Joe Nelson, Hunter, White Scarver, Welt Hatcher, and Frank Williams. Stoughton was occupying a brick house on the outskirts of the village belonging to Dr. Gunnell. When we reached it, all dismounted, and I gave a loud knock on the front door. A head bobbed out from an upper window and inquired who was there. My answer was, 5th New York Cavalry with a dispatch for General Stoughton. Footsteps were soon heard tripping downstairs, and the door opened. A man stood before me with nothing on but his shirt and drawers. I immediately seized hold of his shirt collar and whispered in his ear who I was and ordered him to lead me to the general's room. He was Lieutenant Prentice of the staff. We went straight upstairs where Stoughton was, leaving Welt Hatcher and George Whitescarver behind to guard the horses. When a light was struck, we saw, lying on the bed before us, the man of war. He was buried in deep sleep and seemed to be dreaming in all the fancied security of the Turk on the night when Marco Bazaris with his band burst on his camp from the forest shades. In dreams through court and camp, he bore the trophies of a conqueror. There were signs in the room of having been revelry in the house that night. Some uncorked champagne bottles furnished an explanation of the general's deep sleep. He had been entertaining a number of ladies from Washington in a style becoming a commanding general. The revelers had retired to rest just before our arrival with no suspicion of the danger that was hovering over them. The ladies had gone to spend the night at a citizen's house. Loud and long, I have been told, were the lamentations next morning when they heard of the mishap that had befallen the gallant young general. He had been caught asleep, ingloriously, in bed, and spirited off without even bidding them goodbye. As the general was not awakened by the noise we made in entering the room, I walked up to his bed and pulled off the covering. But even this did not arouse him. He was turned over on his side, snoring like one of the 7 sleepers. With such environments, I could not afford to await his convenience or to stand on ceremony, so I just pulled up his shirt and gave him a spank. Its effect was electric. The brigadier rose from his pillow, and in an authoritative tone inquired the meaning of this rude intrusion. He had not realized that we were not some of his staff. I leaned over and said to him, "General, did you ever hear of Mosby?" "Yes," he quickly answered. "Have you caught him?" "No," I said. "I am Mosby. He has caught you." In order to deprive him of all hope, I told him that Stuart's cavalry held the town and that General Jackson was at Centerville. With a look of agony and despair, he asked if Fitz Lee was there. I told him yes. "Then," he said, "take me to him. We were classmates at West Point." "Certainly," I said, "but I am in a hurry. Dress quick." He had the reputation of being a gallant soldier, but a fop, and dressed as carefully before a looking-glass as Sardanapalus did when he went to war. When we got to the front door, Frank Williams handed him his watch, which he had left in the hurry of departure. White Scarver and Welt Hatcher, who had been left to guard the horses, had not been idle while we were in the house. They had surrounded some tents and captured 7 headquarters couriers besides several fine horses, which we found bridled and saddled. I was determined to bring off the general, even if we had to abandon all our other captures. So I would not let Stoughton hold his bridle reins, but told Hunter to ride by his side and hold them at all hazards. I knew that Hunter would stick to him closer than a brother. Lieutenant Prentice also started with us a prisoner, but as I let him hold his bridle reins, he left us in the dark and never even said good night. When we returned to the courthouse square, all the squads had collected there and duly done their work. There were 29 men with me, and we had about 100 prisoners and horses to guard. It was so dark that the prisoners did not know my men from their own. In the town there were several hundred soldiers, but there was no concert of action among them. All was panic and confusion. Each man was in search of a safe hiding place. Just as we were moving out of the town, a ludicrous incident occurred. As we passed by a house, an upper window was lifted, and a voice called out in a peremptory tone and asked what cavalry that was. It sounded so funny that the men broke out in a loud laugh. I knew that it must be an officer of rank, so the column was halted, and Joe Nelson and Welt Hatcher were ordered to search the house. Lieutenant Colonel Johnstone, of the 5th New York Cavalry, was spending the night there with his wife. For some reason, he suspected something wrong when he heard my men laugh, and immediately took flight in his shirt tail out of the back door. Nelson and Hatcher broke through the front door, but his wife met them like a lioness in the hall, and obstructed them all she could in order to give time for her husband to make his escape. The officer could not be found, but my men took some consolation for the loss by bringing his clothes away with them. He had run out through the backyard into the garden and crawled for shelter in a place it is not necessary to describe. He lay there concealed and shivering with cold and fear until after daylight. He did not know for some time that we had gone, and he was afraid to come out of his hole to find out. His wife didn't know where he was. In squeezing himself under shelter, he had torn off his shirt, and when he appeared before his wife next morning, as naked as when he was born and smelling a great deal worse, it is reported that she refused to embrace him before he had taken a bath. After he had been scrubbed down with a horse brush and curry comb, he started in pursuit of us, but went in the opposite direction from which we had gone. I started with my prisoners and booty towards Fairfax Station just to deceive the enemy as to the route we were going to retreat. After going back half a mile, we wheeled around at right angles and made for the pike that leads from the courthouse to Centerville. Our safety depended on getting beyond the lines before daylight. We struck the pike about halfway between Centerville and the courthouse. Stoughton remarked to me as we were riding along, "Captain, you have done a bold thing, but you are sure to be caught." He was certain every moment of hearing the hoofstrokes of his cavalry coming in hot pursuit. The fact was that everybody at the courthouse seemed to have lost his head. No one seemed to have the presence of mind to try to rally the troops to the defense of the place. We had spent an hour there, raiding all the stables and headquarters, and came away loaded down with prisoners and spoils without even firing a shot or having one fired at us. I knew, though, that they would collect their senses after they found out we were gone and would come after us. After reaching the Centerville Pike, the principal danger was in front. Although we were rapidly getting away from the danger behind us, we were still approaching another, and had to pass by Centerville before we would be safe. Before going out on the pike, I halted the column and told Hunter to close it up. Some of my men were riding in the rear and some on the flank to keep the prisoners from running away. It was so dark, however, that we lost a considerable number. I rode out some distance in advance to reconnoiter along the road. Windham's cavalry corps were then a mile behind us. No sound disturbed the deep stillness of the night. No hostile form was there to intercept us. I called to Hunter to come on. We were then about 4 miles from Centerville. I ordered Hunter to go forward at a fast trot. With Joe Nelson, I stayed some distance in the rear. Hunter was ordered, no matter what happened, to hold on to the general. No doubt Stoughton thoroughly appreciated the interest I felt in him. Nelson and I frequently stopped to listen. Nothing but the hooting of owls could be heard. Every moment my heart beat higher with hope. I am sure that Caesar was not more oppressed with anxiety, nor felt higher aspirations on the eventful morning when he gave the order to the legions that changed the history of the world. My fate was then trembling in the balance. If we should get caught, it would end my career as a partisan. Everybody would say that I had tried to do what I ought to have known to be impossible. The campfires on the heights around Centerville soon became visible through the darkness. I had begun to feel pretty safe from pursuit, but the chief peril lay in flanking the troops at Centerville without running into hostile camps not far away on either side of it. It was as difficult a problem to solve as steering between Scylla and Charybdis. Yet I was cheered by the knowledge that if I succeeded, an adventure so full of romance would strike a deeper impression on the imagination of men than a battle. Nelson and I rode up at a gallop to overtake the column when we saw that it had halted. When we caught up with it, we could see a smoldering fire by the pike about 100 yards ahead of us. It was evidently a picket post. I rode forward alone to reconnoiter. No one was about the fire. The post had just been deserted. I called to Hunter to move on. We were then about a 30 miles from Centerville, and the gray dawn was just beginning to appear. We passed the picket post and then turned off to the right to go over the forts at Centerville. It had been the habit to establish a picket there every night and withdraw it early in the morning. The officer in charge, concluding that there was no danger in the air, had returned to camp and gone to sleep just before we got there. The camps were all quiet, no sign of alarm. We could see the cannon bristling through the embrasures of the redoubts not more than 200 or 300 yards away, and heard the sentinel on the parapet call us to halt. But no attention was paid to it. I was riding down a short distance ahead of the column when I heard a shot. Turning around to see what it meant, I saw Captain Barker dashing toward a redoubt. One of my men, a Hungarian named Jake, who had fired the shot, was just about giving him another when Barker and his horse tumbled in a ditch, which spared Jake the necessity of shooting again. He was soon extricated and mounted, and we marched on. I asked Barker if he was hurt. He replied, no. All this happened in full view of the enemy's camp, which was in gunshot of us. As there were more prisoners with me than I had men, no doubt the sentinels mistook us as we came right from the direction of the cavalry camp for a body of their own cavalry going out on a scout. Nothing, so far as they knew, had occurred during the night to break the monotony of the cry, "All quiet along the Potomac tonight." We were not long in getting around Centerville. Soon after we passed outside the enemy's lines, we got to Cub Run, where a new danger confronted us. The stream was swift and so swollen from the melting snow and rain that we either had to run the risk of swimming it or turn back. But in full view behind were the white tents of the enemy at Centerville, and the cannon pointing at us. I did not deliberate a moment, but plunged into the raging torrent and swam to the other shore. The current was strong, but so was my horse. Stoughton followed next to me. As he emerged, shivering from his morning bath, he said, "Well, Captain, this is the first outrage that I have to complain of." It was a miracle that not a man or a horse was drowned, although many were swept down in the stream. When all were over, I knew that we were comparatively safe and that no cavalry would attempt to swim after us. As we had to make a circle to get back onto the Warrenton Pike, which passes through Centerville, there was danger of a cavalry force being sent from there to intercept us. So again, putting Hunter in command of the column, in company with George Slater, I galloped on to see what was ahead. We passed Sudley and came on the pike at Groveton. This was the very spot where Fitz John Porter had met such a bloody repulse from Stonewall Jackson the year before. We rode off on a high hill from which we could see the road all the way back to Centerville. No enemy was in pursuit, and in a few minutes Hunter appeared in sight. We were safe. Just then there was a glorious sunburst. In the rapture of the moment, I said to Slater, "George, that shines as glorious to me as the sun of Austerlitz." I felt that I had drawn a prize in the lottery of life, for who can contemplate fame through clouds unfold, the star which rises o'er her steep, nor climb? When Stoughton saw the Union camp 7 miles away on the heights around Centerville, he lost all hope of being recaptured. He was young, a professional soldier, and ambitious. Having been captured in a way that would subject him to ridicule, his pride was deeply touched. It is reported that Mr. Lincoln, when he heard of it, remarked with cynical humor that he didn't care so much about the general, as he could make another in 5 minutes, but that he hated to lose the horses. Stoughton's mortification deeply excited my sympathy. When he cast a despairing look at the Union camp behind him, it recalled to my mind the pathetic story of Boabdil, when he turned to look back on the towers of Granada and breathed the last sigh of the Moor. At Warrenton, men, women, and children came out to give us an ovation. I was as proud of it as a Roman general when the Senate had decreed him a triumph. Stoughton had been there before. At West Point, he had been a classmate of a young man named Beckham, whose home was there, and he had spent a vacation with him. We stopped at his house a short time, and he was kindly received by the family. Early the next morning, I reached Culpeper Courthouse with my captures, 1 general, 2 captains, 30 privates, and 58 horses. I remember Fitz Lee's look of surprise when I introduced his old classmate to him. During the day, Stuart arrived from Fredericksburg. He came to attend a court-martial. I met him at the train and shall never forget the delight with which he heard my story. Only 2 months before we had parted at his tent when I started off to seek for adventures. He announced in flattering terms in a general order my exploit to the cavalry. Praise from Stuart was all the reward I wanted. Stoughton's reputation as a soldier was blasted. He was soon exchanged, but never returned to the army. Wyndham was relieved. His successor had no more success in suppressing my depredations than Wyndham, and soon had to relinquish his command. Colonel Johnstone did not survive the ridicule he incurred by his selection of a hiding place and appearing stark naked at headquarters. Major Gilmer, whom he had put under arrest a few days before making a fool of himself when he came after me, now had the laugh on him. He, too, made his exit from the stage. I was never able to duplicate this adventure. It was one of those things a man can do only once in a lifetime. The Northern cavalry got too smart to allow the repetition. My calculation of success was based on the theory that, to all appearances, it was an impossibility. It was charged at the time that citizens of the place were in collusion with me and had given the information on which I had acted. It was not true. I had had no communication with anyone there. Several men, and also a young lady at whose house Stoughton's guests had slept that night, were arrested and sent to prison in Washington. They were all as innocent of the charge of complicity in the act as Mr. Lincoln. The young lady got her revenge by marrying the provost marshal, John S. Mosby. This achievement elicited the following complimentary notice from General J.E.B. Stuart. General Order Number Captain John S. Mosby has, for a long time, attracted the attention of his generals by his boldness, skill, and success, so signally displayed in his numerous forays upon the invaders of his native state. None knew his daring enterprise and dashing heroism better than those foul invaders, those strangers themselves to such noble traits. His late brilliant exploit, the capture of Brigadier General Stoughton, U.S. Army, two captains, 30 other prisoners, together with their arms, equipments, and 58 horses, justifies this recognition in general orders. This feat, almost unparalleled in the war, was performed in the midst of the enemy's troops at Fairfax Courthouse without loss or injury. The gallant band of Captain Mosby share the glory, as they did the danger, of this enterprise, and are worthy of such a leader. J.E.B. Stuart, Major General Commanding. Mosby was then promoted to the rank of Major, with authority to organize a battalion. Chapter 3. A very important aid to Mosby in his successful attacks and surprises was the selection of skillful and intelligent guides and scouts, men familiar with the section of country in which he operated, knowing all the little roads and cowpaths, who could creep through the dense undergrowth or dark ravines like foxes, unobserved, and if discovered easily elude pursuit. Prominent among these were the Underwood brothers, John, Samuel, and Bushrod in Fairfax, John S. Russell in the Shenandoah Valley, and Walter Bowie in Maryland. On Tuesday, the 17th of March, Captain Mosby attacked the reserve picket post of the 1st Vermont Cavalry at Herndon Station in Fairfax. Gaining their rear, he advanced on the post. The sentinel, seeing them coming from the direction of the Federal camp, supposed them to be a patrol and allowed them to approach within a short distance before challenging. The pickets, being surprised, made but little resistance, and the majority were captured, among them one major, one captain, two lieutenants, and 21 privates, together with 26 horses and equipments. One of the Federals was wounded and left on the field. Some of the enemy who escaped gave the alarm, and a force was started in pursuit, but coming up with Mosby's rear guard and receiving a check, abandoned the pursuit. Mosby announced his success to General Stuart in the following report. Near Piedmont, Virginia, March 18, 1863. General, yesterday I attacked a body of the enemy's cavalry at Herndon Station in Fairfax County, completely routing them. I brought off 25 prisoners, a Major Wells, one captain, two lieutenants, and 21 men, all their arms, 26 horses and equipments. One severely wounded was left on the ground. The enemy pursued me in force, but were checked by my rear guard and gave up the pursuit. My loss was nothing. The enemy have moved their cavalry from Germantown back of Fairfax Courthouse on the Alexandria Pike. In this affair, my officers and men behaved splendidly. John S. Mosby, Captain Commanding. Headquarters, Lee's Cavalry Brigade, March 20, 1863. Respectfully forwarded. Such performances need no comment. The soldiers were paroled. The officers will be sent to Richmond. Fitz Lee, Brigadier General. Respectfully forwarded and attention called to this latest achievement of Captain Mosby. In the absence of General Stuart and by command, R. Channing Price, Assistant Adjutant General. Respectfully forwarded for the information of the department and as an evidence of the merit and continued success of Captain Mosby. R. E. Lee, General. While scouting in Fairfax with John Underwood to ascertain the position and strength of the Federal forces, Mosby determined to attempt the surprise of outposts at Chantilly and Frying Pan, there being about 100 cavalry at each of these places. Starting from Rector's Crossroads on the 23rd of March, 1863, he proceeded down the turnpike until within about 6 miles of Chantilly when he left the road, though still keeping the same direction. Coming out from a piece of woods within a mile of the Chantilly mansion, he moved towards the picket posted on a little run on the Little River Turnpike. Seeing the vedettes, some of our men left the ranks and dashed off in pursuit. They suddenly came upon a picket of 10 men which had been thrown out on the turnpike. One was killed and 5 or 6 surrendered and were taken back to Mosby. The alarm being given, the reserves were called out and Mosby, finding the force quite a large one, fell back up the turnpike, the Federals following. Halting at a place where there was a barricade of fallen trees, Mosby formed his men behind this obstruction and awaited their coming. On they came, but in the pursuit they were strung out along the road, and on receiving Mosby's fire, wavered. A charge was now ordered. The Rangers rushed forward with a yell, and the fight became a chase. The Federals were driven back and could not be rallied. The chase was continued for about 3 miles back to the place where it commenced. Here the Federals were reinforced by the reserve from Frying Pan Church, and Mosby was compelled to halt and then retreat. The enemy did not pursue very far, as night was coming on and they were afraid of being led into a trap. Mosby sustained no loss. The Federals lost 5 killed, several were wounded, and 35 prisoners were taken. See Mosby's report, Appendix 2. In response to his dispatch, General Stuart sent the following to Mosby. Headquarters, Cavalry Division, Army of Northern Virginia, March 27, 1863. Captain, your telegram announcing your brilliant achievements near Chantilly was duly received and forwarded to General Lee. He exclaimed upon reading it, "Hurrah for Mosby! I wish I had 100 like him." Heartily wishing you continued success, I remain your obedient servant, J.E.B. Stuart, Major General Commanding. On Tuesday, the 31st of March, Mosby, with his detail and such volunteers as he had been able to muster, numbering in all less than 70 men, moved off towards Drainsville, thence up the Leesburg Turnpike, and camped for the night at Miskell's Farm, on the north side of the road and about 0.5 mile from the Potomac River. Miskell's was selected as a camping ground for the reason that it was the only place for miles around where forage could be procured. Some of the men slept on the floor in the house, where there was a good fire, but the majority took up their quarters in the barn, where there was a plentiful supply of hay. The horses were hitched to the high fence surrounding the barnyard. This fence had a gate opening into a field, through which a road ran leading to the turnpike. The presence of Mosby in the neighborhood was communicated by a Union citizen to the officer in command of the 1st Vermont Cavalry, camped on Difficult Run, and Captain Flint, with 2 squadrons of selected volunteers, started out to surprise and capture the partisans. Dick Moran, one of Mosby's men, had stopped for the night with an old acquaintance named Green, who lived on the road between Drainsville and Miskell's, and Captain Flint, in passing, stopped at Green's house. Moran hid until the Federals had passed, and then, mounting his horse, took a short cut across the fields to warn Mosby of their approach. About sunrise next morning, one of the men came into the house and said he noticed the enemy in the Federal camps on the opposite side of the river were making signals. Mosby went out into the yard to look at them, when he spied Dick Moran riding towards him at breakneck speed, waving his hat and shouting, "Mount your horses, the Yankees are coming!" Mosby rushed to the barnyard on foot to rally his men, and found Flint's 1st Squadron marching through the gate into the field, and they soon opened a brisk fire on the Rangers engaged in bridling and saddling their horses. The fire was returned, however, and Captain Flint fell, mortally wounded, pierced by 6 bullets. Harry Hatcher, seeing his leader on foot, dismounted and gave his horse to Mosby, who once in the saddle led his men in the charge, and Harry was soon mounted on a captured horse and into the thickest of the fight. In their efforts to escape from the furious onslaught of the Rangers, The terror-stricken Federals became wedged in the narrow passage through the gateway, and thus hemmed in, they suffered terribly from the murderous fire poured into them until, bursting through, they rushed frantically out to the woods and turnpike, pursued by the Rangers, who fiercely hung upon their rear. Mosby lost one man killed, Davis of Kentucky, and three wounded, Edward Hurst of Fauquier, Keyes of the 1st Virginia Cavalry, and R.A. Hart of the Black Horse Cavalry. The Federals lost 10 killed, 15 wounded, 83 prisoners, and 95 horses were captured. In Colonel Mosby's reminiscences, he relates an incident in which our artist has shown in the picture of the Miskel fight. There was with me that day a young artillery officer, Samuel F. Chapman, who, at the first call of his state to arms, had quit the study of divinity and became, like Stonewall Jackson, a sort of military Calvin, singing the Psalms of David as he went into battle. I must confess that his character as a soldier was more on the model of the Hebrew prophets than the apostles or the Baptist in whom he was so devout a believer. Before he got to the gate, Sam had already exhausted every barrel of his two pistols and drawn his saber. As the fiery Covenanter rode on his predestined course, the enemy's ranks withered wherever he went. He was just in front of me. He was generally in front of everybody in a fight, at the gate. It was no fault of the Union cavalry that they did not get through any faster than they did, but Sam seemed to think that it was. Even at that supreme moment in my life, when I had just stood on the brink of ruin and had barely escaped, I could not restrain a propensity to laugh. Sam, to give more vigor to his blows, was standing straight up in his stirrups, dealing them right and left with all the theological fervor of Burley of Balfour. I doubt whether he prayed that day for the souls of those he sent over the Stygian River. I made him a captain for it. While General Stahel's division of cavalry was picketing the line of the Orange and Alexandria Railroad, Mosby, with 98 men, bivouacked on the night of May 2nd, about 2 miles from Warrenton, and early on the morning of the 3rd moved off towards Warrenton Junction, where a force of the enemy was reported. Here he found the 1st Virginia Federal Cavalry, who had just been relieved from duty and were resting in fancied security. Some were under the shade of the trees, others in the block buildings, their horses unsaddled, unbridled, and many turned out in a field to graze. They took but little notice of Mosby's men at first, mistaking them for a party of their own men who had been sent out on a scout, but they were soon undeceived when Mosby ordered a charge. Many of those scattered around surrendered immediately, but about 100 took refuge in the largest building and prepared to defend themselves. Then the fight commenced in earnest. Those inside poured out a galling fire on their assailants, while Mosby's men rode up to the windows and discharged their weapons at those within. After the fight had gone on in this manner for about half an hour, and the Federals still refused to surrender, Mosby ordered Alfred Glasscock to set fire to a pile of hay nearby and burn the house. In the meantime, Samuel Chapman, John DeButts, Harry Sweeting, and a few others dismounted, burst in the door, and entering the building opened fire on those inside, at the same time demanding their surrender. The officer upstairs, deeming it useless to resist further, hung out a white flag. Gathering up the prisoners, horses, and captured spoils, the Rangers were preparing to retire when the 1st Vermont and 5th New York Cavalry, attracted by the firing, came up from near Cedar Run Bridge, where they had been bivouacked, and fiercely attacked Mosby. His men, now being thoroughly disorganized, were forced to retreat, leaving most of their prisoners, horses, and other captures behind. Templeton, one of Stonewall Jackson's best scouts, was killed, and about 20 men wounded. Among them, Captain Duchesne, T.W.T. Richards, T.M. Grigsby, Sam Underwood, and Dick Moran. General Stahel, in his dispatch to General Heintzelman, admits a loss of 2 killed and 15 wounded. Major Steele of the 1st Virginia Federal Cavalry was mortally wounded. Mosby brought out 7 prisoners and a few horses. While the prisoners were sitting on the green at Upperville, after the return from the raid, talking with the men around them, the subject of their conversation being the fighting qualities of the different regiments, one of our men said, "Everyone thinks his own regiment the best, but I have a very poor opinion of the 1st Virginia Cavalry." Mosby, overhearing the remark, said, "What do you want to talk that way to prisoners for?" Then, turning to the prisoners, he added, "You all fight as well as we want to have you fight." Raiding parties of Federals, both cavalry and infantry, were constantly scouring the country in all directions in search of Mosby. On their way, these raiders gathered up all the horses and cattle they could find, killed the farmers' stock and poultry, and plundered and destroyed private property. Inoffensive citizens, sometimes old and feeble men, were taken off, exhibited as Mosby's men, guerrillas, or bushwhackers, imprisoned for months, and finally released without knowing why they were taken. In consequence of these practices, as soon as a raiding party commenced its march through the country, everything was in a state of excitement. The men and boys hurried off to the mountains, or to secluded spots with the horses and cattle, notifying their neighbors of the approach of the enemy. Within doors, all was bustle. Everything of value was hidden away in places most likely to escape the scrutiny of a search. Meanwhile, the soldiers, who were the least troubled on such occasions, mounted their horses and were secure in the mountains, or they combined for defense or attack as opportunity might offer. Persons misled by a false alarm, or some even in a spirit of mischief, would at times send out the warning cry of, "The Yankees are coming," when there were no grounds for such reports. On these occasions, however, there would be the same activity displayed and the same confusion existing as in cases of real danger. On the 6th of May, 1863, Major Mosby, Edwin Rousey, and myself were at the house of Mr. George S. Ayer, near Upperville. Dinner was just over, and we remained sitting around when our host came into the room and said, "Major, the Yankees are coming." Mosby picked up his hat and pistols, mounted his horse, which stood saddled at the stile, and rode off. Rousey and I started for the stable to get our horses, but before we reached it, heard firing in the woods at Blakely's Grove, about a mile from the house. We halted, and in a few moments saw a blue coat skirmish line on the crest of a hill opposite, and soon a body of infantry came in view. We concealed ourselves behind a stone fence and crept along, watching them as they moved towards Upperville. A farm bell, which was used to call the hands from the fields to the house, was sounded at this time, and the Federal infantry, evidently thinking it a signal, halted and drew up in line. Rousey and I hastened back to the house, where we were told there had been a fight in the woods and a number of wounded men were there. We threw off our coats and jumped into an ox cart which stood nearby, and with a Negro driver hurried off to the scene of the fight. As we neared the place, a Federal cavalryman rode up and said, "Are there any rebels in the neighborhood?" "I don't know," said I. He said they had been attacked by about 150 rebels. In the woods, we found 5 wounded, and in the road, 1 man and 2 horses killed. The main body had gone towards Upperville, while a few had been left to look after the wounded, who were taken temporarily to the schoolhouse at the Grove. One of the Federals was very communicative. He told me they...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.